Hello there, students. Dr. John Trogge here, and we're ready to start the module about inferential statistics. This is, of course, completing the kinds of information that we were learning about early in the course that we called descriptive statistics, but we'll get to what the difference is and what exactly a definition of inferential statistics means, and more broadly, what we would be doing and what kind of problems we would be solving using inferential statistics. But broadly, this is going to be about deciding what data mean. When you have some data, like how a system is working, like how maybe you have observations of the amount of electrical load on the power grid, or maybe you have temperature observations, or maybe you have the amount of power collected off of a solar cell or something like that. What does it mean? How do you figure out what you can say and what you can't say based on the data that you have? Okay, now earlier in the course, a lot of what we were doing was called descriptive statistics. Just to give you some examples of what we were talking about when we said descriptive statistics, we were talking about quantities like the average, or the sample variance, or the sample standard deviation. Notice that this is all different than parameters. Parameters were actual properties of the system, like the mean, or the variance, or the standard deviation. They were properties of the climate, or the properties of the electrical grid, or they were properties of the community that was consuming electricity, or whatever. There is a real mean temperature in Omaha on this day, but that's not something we can know. That's a parameter, but it's not something we can know. We can come up with estimators of that parameter that we called statistics, and some examples of descriptive statistics were things like average, which is an estimator of the mean, or sample variance, which is an estimator of the real variance of the data, or sample standard deviation, which was an estimator of the real standard deviation in the data. Some more examples. We didn't tend to frame it in that way, but like a lot of the stuff that when we did the statistical modeling, a lot of those regression parameters, for example, would be examples of those. That's a poor choice of words. I'd say better to say regression statistics. The regression statistics like B0 and B1 and so on, the y-intercept of the best fit line and the slope of the best fit line, they are statistics. They are a function of the observations that you have taken of the system, and they reflect or estimate a real parameter of the system, like the beta-naught and beta-1, which are the true parameters that describe the relationship between the phenomena that you were studying when you're making your linear statistical model. A correlation would be another example of a statistic. Okay, it's a descriptive statistic. Based on the sample that we took, these temperatures on these days, and then these observations that we have of the load on the electrical load on the grid on those days, we came up with this correlation. It was a function of just the observations that we took, whereas the parameter that describes those the relationship between the two data would have a different name. Okay, we're not going in that direction in this class. But we had all these descriptive statistics earlier in the semester. A fair question, though, to ask is, what do these descriptive statistics really get us? I mean, our lives are full of descriptive statistics, and if you don't believe me, watch a football game sometime, okay? They can spout statistics all over the place. The question is, what do they actually get us? What are all these ways of describing what's going on, like averages and interquartile ranges and so on, what do they actually get us? How can we actually make decisions about the real world based on that? I mean, it's very common on a sports broadcast for the broadcasters to, say that this player runs for this many yards and this player runs for slightly more yards and therefore he's better. Is he? Or do we only have samples of the games he actually played? That's a difficult guess. I mean, you don't actually know that he's a better player based on that statistic. A simpler analogy, though, to draw. Let's say we wanted to answer a question. We wanted to know who's taller, the average Creighton student or the average UNO student. Okay, this is the kind of problem that it seems like descriptive statistics should be able to solve for us. And what we're going to find out is, no, we're going to need some other way of figuring this out. See, one strategy, if we were going to be trying to figure out if the average Creighton student was the height taller or shorter than the average UNO student, would be to go and take a sample of Creighton students and find their average height. That would be an easy enough thing to do. Now, how to pick the sample, that's a whole business of a discipline called sampling theory, and sampling theory is a whole sub-discipline within statistics itself. Okay, but let's just say we're going to make this really simple. We're just going to take the next five guys to five people to leave the library. Okay, and we're going to take them and we're take their average height. Next 100 people to leave the library. You know, but you now you probably still have biases there. Maybe the people who go to the library tend to be taller, or maybe the people who go to the library at this time of day tend to be shorter, or something. This is fraught with problems. But you could take a sample of students at Creighton, and you could measure them, and you could take their compute their average height. It is the average height of just those students. It's the average height of at the time that you measured them. I mean, some of them might be growing. So if you measured them tomorrow, you'd get a slightly different number. But okay, we could have a descriptive statistic. The average of my sample is not the mean height of Creighton students, but it's an estimator of the mean height of students. And you could do the same thing with UNO students. You could take their, you know, a sample of them as they left the library or the business building or something. And again, that's fraught with problems. Maybe students in the business school at UNO are shorter than students in the engineering school or something like that, all of which is fraught with problems. But one could envision that one could make this work. And then you could have it measure them. And you would have the average height of the UNO students that is, well, it's not the mean of the height of the UNO students, but it is an estimator of the mean at the present time. Okay, then let's say you actually did that. And I'll just use the symbol Z to be our symbol for height. Meteorologists always use Z for height. It has to do with the X, Y, and Z coordinates. And so let's say that Z bar of CU was the average height of our sample of students from Creighton. And let's say that Z bar UNO was our average height of students from University of Nebraska-Omaha. And let's just say you crank the numbers and it turns out that the average was bigger at Creighton than it was at UNO. Does this mean that the mean height of Creighton students is greater than the mean height of UNO students? It sure seems like that. And again, watch a football game sometime, the broadcasters are going to say, you know, this guy runs for more yards than this guy does, therefore he's a better player, or whatever. But this is a statistic. It's not the mean. We're not saying the mean. This does not necessarily tell us that the mean height of Creighton students. It says that this sample of students was taller than that sample of students. It's intellectually lazy to think that that means that the means are different. This is going to be a very tricky problem that forms the core of what this module is all about. How do we actually decide how to use that information to figure out what this tells us about how the means of the two groups are different? I mean, our average height of these Creighton students was completely dependent on the students that were in the sample. If I just happened to be picking my students, you know, in my sample just happened to get a lot of students who are on the Napoleon Impersonators Club and they are short, or you happen to get a whole lot of the members of the basketball team at the present time and they're tall, your average is going to be kind of screwy. I mean, if you took a different sample of students from Creighton, you measured them, you know, tomorrow, and you got a different group of students, you'd get a different value of Z bar CU. This is a problem. It's not obvious how you can fix this. In fact, we could take observations of different samples of Creighton students and measure each of those samples' average height and make like a histogram of that. And that's kind of what I did here. I just faked this, and I'll show you after a while how I actually did it. But this would be like what we would get if we actually just kept taking more and more samples of Creighton students. I mean, let's say I ran such an experiment 1,000 times. 1,000 times I took my sample. I picked up the next 10 Creighton students to come out of the administration building. I took the next 10 students to come out of one of the dorms, or whatever. I picked 10 students at random, took their average height. I did that 1,000 times. Obviously, some students got sampled lots of times, some never got sampled at all. It's an experiment. Let's say I ran that little experiment a whole bunch of times and got a histogram like this. Now, this is not the histogram. This is not showing the heights of individual students, ranging from like 159 centimeters to 181 centimeters. I'm saying this is the histogram of the average. Sometimes, I mean, don't get me wrong, there's some really short students and there's some really tall students that would be way off this chart, but if I took an average of like 10 students as they came by, sometimes there would be a lot of the times the average would be around 170 centimeters. You know, sometimes 171, sometimes 172, sometimes 173, but in that general range, that's where it falls a lot of the time. There's some really short students in there, but there's also really tall students, and they average it out. But here's the deal. Every once in a while, I would end up with a group that the average is really quite low, just by chance. Okay? You just happen to pick a bunch of short people as part of your random sample. That doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. And in the same way, sometimes you end up with a group that just happens to have a lot of really tall students in it. These are all perfectly legitimate averages, but they have some distribution to them, kind of a bell-shaped curve, actually. In fact, you can see how it's kind of got a mean to it. Somewhere around 170, 171 is the real mean of these heights, but we have a variance or a standard deviation around it, as we have this sort of bell-shaped curve showing this distribution of these students. Sometimes just by dumb luck, you get a really tall group. Sometimes just by dumb luck, you get a really short group. Most of the time, you get a group that's sort of under the hump of the distribution there, where, yeah, within the group, there's some taller and there's some short people, but the average works out to being about 170. How did I actually do this, by the way? I totally faked this. All I did is I had Excel pick 1,000 groups, each of 10 random numbers between, I forget what the numbers that range I gave it was. Now we can do the same sort of thing for UNO. As I switched to red for UNO, whereas I had blue for Creighton, I was kind of happy with that technique there. The same is true for the UNO students. I mean, there's going to be a whole bunch of them up there. I mean, a whole bunch, this is not the range of the individual students. This is the range of the little groups that I took. It was 10, samples of 10. So I picked 10 students, and, you know, most of the time the average was right around 170, 171. Okay, each of those groups contained a range of heights, but the average worked out to be about 170, 171 centimeters. But some of those groups are really short. I mean, sometimes the average of the 10 students was like 159 centimeters. And sometimes the groups were really tall. There was a couple times where there was over 180 centimeters for the average for the group of 10 students. Again, it was fake. I just had Excel draw random numbers. But you can see we get kind of a bell-shaped distribution here. There is some hump, there's some mode to the distribution. It's an estimator of the mean. So would be the median of this group, so would be the average of the group. They're all estimators of the true mean height of the UNO students. But you can see perfectly good groups. I mean, we don't always fall all that close to the true average height, the true mean of UNO. Speaking of the true mean, in Excel, where I made these plots, you actually set what you want the mean to be, and then it picked random numbers around there. Both, in this case, both Creighton and UNO were set to be have a mean of 170 centimeters. So anyway, so I put those two graphs side by side here. Let's say that I ran 1,000 experiments of my height of my Creighton students over there on the left, and I ran 1,000 experiments of the height of my UNO students on the right there. You know, the value of this average height, you can see, has a huge range. Okay, there's a true mean, in this case, for both UNO and for Creighton. Happens to be 170 centimeters. I set it as part of the little statistical tool that I used. But, you know, when I picked 10 students at random from the group of distribution, sometimes the average was quite a bit higher than 170 centimeters. Sometimes it was a whole lot less. So simply having taken one sample of Creighton students and saying, their average was greater than the average height of the UNO students, does not mean that I can say that the mean heights of those Creighton students is greater than the mean height of the UNO students. I mean, if I took a sample of the students from each school and just happened to see the Creighton sample height was greater than UNO sample height, well, that could mean a lot of different things, one of which being that maybe Creighton students are taller than UNO students. But it's also possible that I just happened to choose one of the samples of 10 students that was pretty tall, had some taller students in it. Maybe I just happened to choose one of the groups of Creighton students that are ridiculously tall. If you pick 10 students at Creighton and their average height is 180 centimeters, you've got a really tall group. It's not very representative of what real Creighton's students' mean height is. But that's a perfectly legitimate sample. It could be that you would just randomly choose 10 students and you just happen to get 10 tall ones. In the same way, it could be that we just got a fairly short group of UNO students. Our sampling technique just happened to get bad luck, and a handful of students who came by were shorter than average. They dragged the average down, and we have a fairly short group of UNO students. For that matter, it's entirely possible that we chose a really short group of students. I don't know, the UNO Jockeys Club or something just happened to be coming by, and you ended up with them in your sample, and you've got this, you know, you've got an average height of only 159 centimeters. Okay. But that doesn't tell us really, I mean, that doesn't very well represent the mean of UNO students at height at all. We need some way to be able to figure out how we can decide what all this means, how to infer the significance of the descriptive statistics that we have been using so far. How do we make a decision? You guys can compute averages. You can do it in an octave. You can do it on spreadsheets. You can do it on paper. I have every confidence you can compute an average. How do you decide what that average means? How do you decide if that means that one group is taller than the other, or one solar panel does produce more power than the other, or one city, 1 hour does draw more electrical power than another hour does, or 1 year was warmer than the year before it? Well, that's all the business of the so-called inferential statistics. Inferential comes from, of course, the word infer, and infer can be a word that people use and hope nobody calls them on. We're gonna make sure we know what the word infer means. So I just pulled this, I just googled define infer, just because why not. And I liked the definition that came up, and so I just cut and pasted it in here. To infer is to deduce or conclude information from evidence and reasoning rather from explicit statements. In other words, there's no way to explicitly just get the information I want. I want to know if Creighton students are taller than UNO students. I want to know if this solar cell is more produces more power than that solar cell, or if this location is windier than this location, or whatever. But there's no one to ask, okay? We don't know the mean of those locations. What we need is some way to infer that from information from evidence and reasoning. Like, for example, observations. Okay, we have observations of the amount of power generated by these two different solar panels. We have information like how windy these two stations are, or whatever. Can we infer from that what the truth is, the nature of the relationship underneath? If you actually then proceed to follow the link to Google inferential statistics, you find out that inferential statistics makes inferences about populations using data drawn from the population, that is the sample. Instead of using the entire population to gather the data, the statistician collects samples from the millions of residents that will make inferences about the entire population of the sample. So this particular descriptive and inferential statistics was being more specifically talking about like sampling all the people in the country or something like that. But this idea that we are making inferences about the whole population, remember the population is all possible Creighton students. All possible UNO students. Not even just the ones that are there now. All possible Creighton students. All possible UNO students. Or all possible days that that solar panel would be out. Or that solar panel would be out. Or how windy it would be on all possible days at that location. Well, there's just no way to know that. But you could make inferences about it. You could reach conclusions based on evidence and reasoning about that, based on like the observations of the solar power being produced by that panel, or how windy that station was, or whatever. I kind of liked what your book actually had to say about this. The book, its definition or whatever, it was saying that inferential statistics is traditionally understood as consisting of methods and procedures that are used to draw conclusions regarding the underlying processes that generate the data. So like if I'm comparing two solar panels, okay? Under the panel's hood, there's a reason why this panel might be making more power than that panel. Maybe the coatings on the glass, or I don't know enough about solar panels to know. There's a reason why this station is more windy than that station, okay? And if we knew all about the meteorology and the physics and the landforms and things like that around there, we could actually explain why one was windier than the other. But instead, we are using inferential statistics to make inferences, to traditionally understand, to draw conclusions about the underlying processes, okay? I don't need to know the exact details of the meteorology as to why this station is windier than this one. I'm using observations of how windy it is at this one to make an inference. This station is in a statistically significant way windier than that one. Oh, man. That's at the core of what we're learning in this module. We're learning about how scientists and engineers design experiments or models to test ideas and to infer information based on their observations. We're going to be learning about words like statistical significance and hypothesis testing and how that all fits into how we design and improve systems and so on. That's really cool. I think this is going to be a great module. All right. Take a little break. Let me know if you have any questions before you move on to the next lecture.